Right, I've stopped at 22405. Do you recognize the two people or the figures that are depicted here in this video? Coming in front of the garage right here?
Yes.
And who are those two people?
Mr. Hernandez and myself. And
how could you tell it's you and Mr. Hernandez?
I know myself because of my walk, but I had a yellow t-shirt. It's the clothes that we wore to go up there. Mr. Hernandez had on a gray t-shirt. And the gray jeans. It's the clothes we left Connecticut in.
Mr. Bradley, the individuals we see on the screen here, who is that?
Myself and Mr. Hernandez.
And where were you going at that point? You came from the area of the garage.
It appears as though we're walking towards in the direction the vehicle is parked. I mean.
Now, when you got out of the car, Mr. Bradley, and walked, what direction did you walk in relation to Club Cure?
When I got out of the car?
When you pulled. Where the area where you said you parked, you got out of the car, is that correct?
Yes.
What was your intention?
I was waiting for the club to let out, hoping to find, I was looking for women to see what women were around.
Was there any conversation with Mr. Hernandez as to where you were going to park?
Prior to me parking?
Yes.
In the spot? Yeah, there was some conversation. He said park right here when we saw the open spot. He said pull over and park right there.
After you pulled over and parked right there, you got out of the car, is that correct?
Correct.
Did Mr. Hernandez say what his intention was in getting out of the car?
No.
What happened after you got out of the car? Where did you walk?
I believe we walked back down towards the garage somewhat, closer to where the clubs are at, so we could be more in the mix of where people would be when the club let out.
Once you got up near the garage, at some point, did you turn back and go to the car?
Yes.
What caused you to go back to the car?
Mr. Hernandez said, there they go, there they go.
Did you see what he was referring to when he said, there they go, there they go?
At the beginning, no.
What happened next?
I walked back to the car. Well, we walked back to the car. I got in the driver's side. He got into the passenger side of the car.
Did he say anything at that point?
Yeah, he was saying, go, go, go.
What did you understand he was referring to?
Well, I knew he was referring to that a BMW passed at a certain point past us, and he was like, go. And
when the BMW passed, he said, go.
Yes.
Did he point to the BMW, or did you just see it on your own?
I'm not sure if he pointed, but I knew he gestured towards it out the window, like, go.
When did he say, there they go?
As the car, like, I believe, well, I mean, at the time he said there, didn't see a car yet, so I don't know.
Were you still outside of the car at that point when he said there they go?
Yes.
And then you got into the car, and what did you see or hear Mr. Hernandez do next?
He was telling me to go, because a BMW rolled by after that, and I went to the light,
You pulled out of into traffic?
Yeah, put my blinker on, pulled out into traffic, and there was a light very shortly thereafter.
And a stoplight?
Yeah, red light. There was a vehicle, I believe, on my left, and I went around the vehicle so I could see cross traffic before I went through the light.
Did you stop at the light, though, initially?
Yes.
And the vehicle to your left, do you remember what that looked like?
I'm not exactly sure what kind of vehicle it was.
Do you remember how close you got to that vehicle?
Well, I went around the vehicle, so, I mean, I believe I went from behind it to around it.
And once you got around it and stopped at the light, what happened next?
I looked both ways, went through the light, made sure there was no traffic coming.
Was the light red?
Yes, the light was red.
Why did you go through the light?
Mr. Hernandez was telling me to go.
What did he say exactly?
He was saying, he said, go, to catch up to the car, the BMW that passed.
Did you go through the light?
Yes.
What was your intention at that point?
To pull up to the car.
What, if any, observations did you make prior to that point regarding the glove box?
After I got through that light, as I was approaching the car, he removed the firearm from the glove box.
He being who?
Mr. Hernandez.
What did you think was going to happen, Mr. Brown?
I thought at the very most he might try to intimidate him, or, you know, maybe say something or address the issue that happened previously in the club.
Did you have any idea he was going to do anything more than that?
No.
Did he state anything about what his intentions were?
No.
After he said go and you went through the red light and observed the gun being taken out, what happened next?
As I was approaching, there was another light after that. I believe that car was at a red light. I believe the light was red. And as I was approaching the car, he told me, watch out. You know, he was telling me, roll the window down first is what he said. Roll the window down. And I rolled the window down. And when we got up to the car, like right when we were approaching, he put his hand on my chest and was like, watch out, like indicating for me to, like, you know, like pushing me back kind of in a seat, like so I could lean back.
Did you lean back?
Yes, I did.
How did you do that?
With the power, the button on the side. I reclined the seat.
What happened next?
I rolled the window down, reclined the seat, and he leaned across me and extended his body out the window with the firearm in his hand.
And when you say extended his body out the window, was his whole body out of the window or just a part of his body?
Not his whole body. He extended from where he was sitting in the car across me, like, you know, across where I'm sitting, onto my side. He was bracing himself, like, off the, I believe, I want to say, somewhere on the floorboard, maybe near. He planted his feet over on his side and leaned across me, extended across my body.
And what about his hands? Where were his hands positioned?
He wound up placing his hand in the area of the armrest, I believe, on the armrest.
And for the record, you're taking your left hand and placing it to your left?
Yeah, well, the armrest would be to his left, correct.
And what hand was he holding the gun in?
His right hand.
What did he do with that arm and hand?
He stuck it out the window. He stuck fully extended across.
Where were you? Where was the car in relation to the BMW at this point?
The car was side by side, like real close.
What, if anything, did you observe about the interior inside of the car, the BMW?
I remember all of them, at least the two front ones with their head down. A gentleman was holding a phone in his hand, and that was it. They were.
What did Mr. Hernandez do or say?
He said, yo, one time, and the gentleman didn't respond. Like, nobody turned around from the car. They weren't aware of the fact that we had pulled up right on the side.
How loudly did he say, yo?
He was, like, loud enough trying to get their attention.
After he said, yo, what happened next?
He wound up saying, yo, again, and then they turned, and then he started firing rounds into their vehicle.
Did he say something before he fired?
Before he fired the gun, he was like, what's up now, niggas? And he started firing shots.
Did he say, what's up now, niggas, after they turned or before they turned?
After they turned, because originally they didn't know we were there. So after he got their attention by saying, yo, when they turned, he said, what's up now, niggas, and started firing shots into the car.
How many shots did you hear fired?
He fired five shots, five rounds.
Did you hear anything after the five shots?
Yeah, clicking. He fired rounds, and the gun began clicking after. I heard like three or four clicks.
Clicks coming from the gun?
Coming from the gun.
Did you turn towards where the shots were being fired? Did you see inside the car at all at that point?
No, I turned away from where the shots were firing. I turned my head to the right. Like once he fired, began firing the shots, I turned my head this way, which would be towards him.
What happened after he fired those five shots and you heard the clicking?
He was like, go. Like, he was like, go. You know, after the clicks, he was like, come on, let's go, let's go.
Where did you go? Which direction?
I pulled off through that street light, and I made a right, which wound up being a one-way street. The street I made a turn onto was a one-way. So when I realized it was a one-way, I made another, well, U-turn in the middle of that street, and the light was red then, so I got caught at that red light.
So you actually stopped at the red light?
Yes.
Did you look over at the BMW?
Yes.
What did you see?
I saw, the first thing I saw was a cab driver. I remember there was a cab driver, his head came. He must have had his head down. I remember his head popped up. And then I saw an individual get out that BMW and was like, someone, it appeared like they were running. Someone was running from the BMW. Someone got out and ran.
And how many people did you see run out of the BMW?
I believe two people. I know one ran for sure, but two got out the car.
Which way did they run?
The individual that ran from the rear driver's side was running up the street towards, I mean, I don't know if it's a north or south direction, but.
How do we approach?
You may. We remain focused on the evidence, that is, on the testimony as it's coming before them, without undue distraction. So I'm going to ask anyone in the audience to please refrain from making any noises, any sounds, any movements that might distract the jury. To the extent there's anyone in the audience who would find it difficult to hear the testimony as it's being presented, this would be an appropriate time to simply step out of the courtroom. These proceedings are being shown in another courtroom across the hall, courtroom 806, I'm sorry, 906. 914, excuse me. And to the extent anyone finds it difficult to refrain from emotional outbursts here, there is an opportunity to observe the proceedings without disrupting the proceedings in any way. Mr. Hagen, as our jurors are lined up to come back in, perhaps you could speak to your advocate. All right, we'll line up the jurors.
You testified that you saw two individuals from the BMW run from the BMW, is that correct?
One I know ran, another one at least got out the car.
And do you have any idea which way the one ran, what direction, in relation to where the highway is, if you know?
He was running not back down towards Cureway. He got out and was running up towards where we would have been at the intersection, if you understand what I'm saying.
And Mr. Bradley, I'm just placing on the screen what's been entered as exhibit number 6. Do you recognize the car depicted in that photograph, sir?
Yes.
And which car is that?
That's the BMW.
Is that the BMW that you saw the defendant shoot into?
Yes.
This is exhibit 12 on the screen. Do you recognize that, sir?
Yes.
And is this the side on which you pulled alongside the BMW?
Yes.
And is this the side from which you saw the defendant shoot into the car?
Yes.
Is this the vehicle that you saw one, perhaps two people running from it?
Yes.
After seeing the two people run and you were stopped at the light after going the wrong way, what did you do next?
Waited for the light to turn green.
What was Mr. Hernandez saying or doing at that point?
At that point, nothing yet.
When the light turned green, where did you go?
I went straight. Went through the light, headed towards the highway.
Did you know where you were going?
No, at a certain point, Mr. Hernandez, you started using his phone to GPS.
You know. Now, as you headed towards the highway, did you see any construction work or anything like that?
Yes, there was road work going on. There was the traffic was at a full stop. There was an officer directing traffic, a police officer.
And did you go by that officer?
Yes.
After going by the officer, were you able to get on a highway?
Yes.
Do you know which highway?
It was a highway right, pretty close to where the officer was at.
Did you choose which way to go, or were you being told which way to go by Mr. Hernandez?
I believe I was being told which way to go by Mr. Hernandez.
Once you got on to the highway, sir, was it a highway that had a toll or didn't have a toll?
Yes, it was a highway that had a toll.
And do you now know what highway that is?
I believe that's the Mass Pike.
As you started to drive, sir, was there any conversation at that point before getting to the toll?
Before getting to the toll, he made a comment when he asked me. He said to me, did I see that? And I said, no. He said, I hit one in the head and one in the chest.
And how did he say that? I mean, was he saying it in a, what was his tone in saying that?
He was panicked, like a panic tone, like a state of shock.
So it wasn't a bragging tone, it was more of a state of shock?
Yeah, it wasn't a bragging tone, it was more like shock.
How did you respond to him saying, I got one in the head, one in the chest?
I mean, I didn't really respond.
What was going through your mind at this point, Mr. Bradley?
I was panicked as well. I was in a state of shock, just as Mr. Hernandez was.
Where was the gun at this point?
The gun was still in his person.
In his hand, in his lap, where was it?
I'm not exactly sure. It was on him.
As you started to drive down what you've identified as the Massachusetts Pike, what happened next?
At some point, we came to a toll booth, and Mr. Hernandez handed me money to hand the toll guy.
And you handed the toll collector money?
Yes.
Did you go through the toll after handing the money?
Yes, we went through the toll.
After going through the toll, was there any further conversation between you and Mr. Hernandez over the next few miles?
Not right away, but at a point.
Did you notice something on the highway?
Yes.
What did you notice?
At a point, a state trooper pulled out behind us from off to the side of the road, or it was right near that toll booth. Like after we got past the toll booth, the state trooper pulled behind us, and at that point, he followed us for a little while. I'm not sure how long, but he got off the first exit. And when the trooper got behind us, I got worried. So once he got off the exit, I told Mr. Hernandez, you need to get rid of that gun.
What did you see him do at that point?
He removed his shirt and wiped the gun down. Stuck the gun, was hanging out the window. He disposed of the shells that were in the gun.
When you say disposed of the shells, how did he do that?
He was removing the shell casings that were left from the inside of the gun. And then he threw the gun.
What about the shirt that he was wearing? Was that the same shirt you had given him?
Yes.
What did he do with the shirt before throwing the shells and the gun out the window? You said he wiped something?
Yeah, he took the shirt off and wiped the handgun with it.
Was he bare-chested at that point?
At that point, yes. When he was wiping the gun, he was bare-chested.
Did he? What did he do with the shirt when he was done?
At some point, he put it back on. I mean, I don't remember if it was right away, but he put the shirt back on.
Was there more, after he threw what you believe the gun and the shells out the window, was there more conversation during that ride home?
Not much. I remember him saying, don't tell anybody.
What did he say in that regard?
He just said, no, don't say nothing.
Those
to anybody,
Don't say nothing?
Yeah. Better not say nothing or something like that.
Did you know where you were going at that point on the highway, or did you have to get directions somehow?
I was driving based on his GPS. That he had a GPS in his phone. At some point, he plugged in. I don't know exactly what he put into his phone, but we were using the GPS.
Do you recall whether or not you got lost on the way driving?
I believe so. We did get lost. At some point, we detoured some way or another. We took a different route than what I'm used to taking. Something was different.
Where were you headed?
I don't know exactly. I don't believe it that. At that point in time, I had any idea of where we were headed.
Who was directing whom? Were you just driving, or was Mr. Hernandez directing you where to go?
I was driving, and we were using his GPS, so he was kind of telling me where to go.
And at some point was a decision made where you were going to go?
Yes.
When was that? How far into the trip?
I mean, a while into the trip. It wasn't right away, but at some point into the trip. I mean, I don't know an exact time interval, but...
And who decided where you were going to go?
I wind up saying at a point that, you know, I was just going to go to my daughter's mother's house. I just wind up driving there.
Had Mr. Hernandez at any point suggested where you should go prior to that?
I don't believe so. I don't exactly recall. I mean, at one point, I think we were going to go towards Plainville and wind up rerouting somehow Plainville, Mass, and wind up...
And what was in Plainville? What was there?
Plainville was where he was living at the time.
But you ended up not going to Plainville?
We end up not going to his residence in Plainville.
So did you enter the state of Connecticut later that early morning hour?
Yes.
When you got to Connecticut, you indicated that you decided to go to your baby's mother's house?
Correct.
Why didn't you go to your house in Manchester?
No particular reason. I can't justify that. I mean, I don't have a reason. I just went to my daughter's mother's house. It's a safe place for me. It's a place I know. It's like a comfortable place for me.
What time in the morning was it when you got into that area? And I should go back up a little bit. Where did your baby's mother live at the time?
She lived in Hartford, Connecticut.
How far is Hartford from Manchester?
It's like 15 minutes from where I was living.
Do you know about what time it was when you arrived in Hartford?
It was over into the morning, I believe. I know it was daylight, so maybe 5 in the morning around.
Did you
expect in 4 or 5 in the morning?
Did you call your baby's mother first? Before you arrived?
Yes, I believe. Oh, I don't recall if I recalled her. I think I did call her because I wouldn't have been able to get in, so I had to notify her.
What is her name?
Brooke Wilcox.
W-I-L-C-O-X?
Yes.
Do you remember the address where Ms. Wilcox was living?
47 Newberry Street.
In Hartford, Connecticut?
Hartford, Connecticut.
When you arrived, where did you park the SUV, if you recall?
The back door of her apartment is on a one-way street, so I parked it on that street. The street behind, I believe it's, I think it's Glendale. I'm not.
Was that where you would always park when you went to visit her, or was that different?
That's where we always usually parked, on a back street.
When you parked the car, did the two of you get out?
Yes.
Where did you go?
Went upstairs into her apartment.
Did you knock on the door, or did you have a key?
I believe she threw the key down from the second floor window. She wound up dropping. When I got in touch with her, I believe through a phone call, however, she dropped the key out the window and I unlocked the door and went up.
When you went up, and was Ms. Wilcox alone or was a child there with her?
She was there with my daughter.
When you got up the stairs and saw Ms. Wilcox, where was Mr. Hernandez with you?
Yes.
What happened next?
We went into the apartment and I kind of went off towards it. Well, she asked me what was wrong as I was walking towards the back room, and I told
her. Why did she ask you what was wrong, or what were you doing then before she said what's wrong?
I must have looked like I was in a state of shock still. Or, yeah.
When she asked you what was wrong, did you answer her?
Yes.
What did you say?
I told her that Mr. Hernandez had just shot 2 people.
Where was Mr. Hernandez when you said this?
Not far from where I was telling her. I mean, it's a small apartment, so I was entering her bedroom from the kitchen area. He was off towards the living room, but still near the kitchen. He was in close proximity. He wasn't that far away.
And you said to Ms. Wilcox that he did what?
That he shot 2 people in Boston.
Did he react at all when you did he seem to hear you?
I wasn't in his direct view still, like in his line of sight when I was telling her. I was walking off towards her bedroom.
What happened next, sir?
After that, he asked. We wind up giving him a pillow and a blanket. He wanted a pillow and a blanket to lay down on the couch. And I believe maybe some sweatpants or something. And
where did you go?
I went to the bedroom with Ms. Wilcox.
At any point did the defendant, Mr. Hernandez, come in to tell you or show you something?
Yes, he came in.
What did he do?
He said, come here, come look. I want to show you something.
Did you go follow him to see what he was referring to?
Yes.
What did you see?
I exited the bedroom and went into the living room, and it was, I believe, Channel 61, the news was showing the incident in Boston, this incident that we're here for.
On the news was showing the incident?
Yes.
What did you see on the TV screen?
I remember seeing detectives walking in a row. They were in a straight line, and they were looking on the ground, like looking for shells, it appeared, and they had some evidence markers out, I believe.
When this was shown to you by Mr. Hernandez, did he say anything about it? Was there any conversation?
No, not much. I kind of looked, and then I remember just kind of going back towards the room.
What happened next, sir?
I believe he asked to use a phone, asked for a phone, and for her laptop computer.
Do you know about what time this was? Was it late morning, mid morning?
It was not long after we were there, so I don't know the exact time, but I'll say all within an hour.
Now, you said he asked for a phone. Do you know what happened? Was his phone with him?
Yes, his phone died at some point going back.
How did you know that?
Because I was in the car with him when it died. His phone died.
When he said he needed a phone, did you or Ms. Wilcox give him access to a phone?
Yes, he did receive a phone.
Do you know which phone?
One of us gave him. It could have been my phone. It could have been. I don't remember exactly, but we gave him a phone. I know there was a house phone at the time. My phone was available.
Did you see him make a phone call or do something with the phone?
Yeah, I saw him start to dial a number. Like, he dialed. He used the phone, yes.
Did you hear any of the conversation he had on the phone?
No, not particularly. Like, I didn't hear exactly the conversation, no.
Now, you indicated that he also asked to use a laptop.
Yes.
Where was the laptop, if you recall?
I believe the laptop was in her bedroom at the time, or it might have been in the living room, but he asked to use the computer.
Did you or Ms. Wilcox let him use the computer?
Yes.
What did you see him do with the computer, if you know?
He was watching the news. He was doing the same thing on the computer, like looking at the same information.
Information on what?
On this incident that we're here for.
Did you say anything? Was there any more conversation with you about it?
Not much, because I spent the majority of the time after that in the back room.
In what room?
In Ms. Wilcox's bedroom, like the back room away from him.
Calling your attention to sometime after the phone call or the use of the phone you observed Mr. Hernandez do, did at some point somebody arrive at the house?
Yes.
Who arrived at the house?
A relative of his.
Which relative?
Ms. Singleton.
Is that Tanya Singleton, sir?
Correct.
And that's the individual you previously testified about?
Correct.
What address did she live at?
Lake Avenue. I don't know the exact number off my head.
What color was their house?
Blue, I believe, light blue.
When she arrived at the house, could you tell how she had gotten there?
Originally, no, I couldn't. I don't believe I don't know what exactly how she got there, but she arrived at the house.
Where did you first see her? Was she in a certain part of the house?
Yeah, she was in the hallway area, kind of like right where you enter the door. It's a hallway because it's a three-family apartment. So she was speaking with Mr. Hernandez in the hallway and by the door. And I believe she came like just into the house, like not deep into it, like into the home a little bit. And they were talking. Well, they were talking in a whispering tone.
They were talking in a whispering tone?
Yeah, they were speaking in a low tone.
Just placing exhibit 203 on the screen. Do you recognize that woman, sir?
Yes.
Who is that?
It's Ms. Singleton.
Is that the woman who arrived at Ms. Wilcox's house in the morning on July 16th, 2012?
Yes.
Is this the individual who you described having a whispered conversation with the defendant?
Yes.
Had she knocked on the door at all, or had somebody just gone out to let her in? Had she knocked on the door, or had someone just let her in? If you know.
If I recall correctly, I think there was a phone call. I think she called, or somehow he knew she was there ahead of time when she got there, and then he kind of met her like at the door. She came upstairs and met her at the door.
After the conversation between the two of them that you described, what happened next, sir?
After that, Ms. Singleton, she came in, she spoke with him, and she left.
Were you able to see outside to see what vehicle she came or left in?
Well, when she left, from the angle I have from where the Toyota was parked, out of the pantry window, you could see, you know, the direct line. The car's in direct view. So you, the car was parked right next to a garage.
Which car are we talking about?
The silver SUV.
The 4Runner?
The 4Runner. When she left, that car was gone, and a white Maxima was left there.
The silver 4Runner SUV was gone?
Yes.
What kind of car was left there?
A Nissan Maxima, a white one.
Do you know whose car that was?
That was Miss Singleton's.
Had you seen her with that previously?
I seen it at that residence of on Lake Ave at the house parked in that driveway several times.
What did you see Mr. Hernandez do next?
Next, I mean, some more time went by. I don't recall exactly.
Did you ever, at that morning, did you ask him where the SUV went, who took it?
Yeah, he said he was going to have Miss Singleton clean the car and store it.
What did he say exactly about that?
He said he told her to take it and clean it up and put the car in the garage.
Did he tell you why he wanted her to do that?
No, I knew why.
Why was that, sir?
Because of the incident that just occurred.
Did he say how he asked her to clean it, what she was supposed to do?
I don't recall if he did or didn't, but I just remember him telling me he took her to clean the car, told her to clean the car up and hide it.
How did Mr. Hernandez end up leaving Miss Wilcox's house? Did he use a certain car?
Yes.
What did he use?
Maxima.
The white Maxima that you saw outside?
Yes.
And that's the Maxima that you'd seen at a certain address?
Yes.
Bradley, I'm placing exhibit 197 on the screen. Do you recognize the house depicted in the photograph?
Yes.
Whose house is that?
Miss Singleton's.
And is that the house where you saw the white Maxima previously parked?
Yes.
Placing exhibit 198 on the screen. Is that a photograph of the same house but showing the driveway area?
Yes.
How long did you stay at Ms. Wilcox's house that day, Mr. Bradley?
I don't recall.
Was Mr. Hernandez still there when you left, or did he leave, or had he left already?
I believe I left right around the same time as him, either shortly thereafter, or I don't remember exactly.
Mr. Bradley, what happened over the next several days and weeks in regards to your relationship with the defendant, Aaron Hernandez?
We kind of just kept our distance from one another a little bit. Like, there was some communication, but we didn't. There was less contact, less daily contact, and less hanging out.
At some point, did that change?
Yes.
What happened?
We began hanging back out again like we used to.
Did you start going back to clubs?
Yes.
How frequently?
It was progressive. It got back to just as much as we used to.
Did you ever have a conversation with the defendant over those next few weeks and months about the silver SUV and what he expected to be done with it?
I don't think I recall any particular conversation other than the fact that, you know, on the original date, nothing stands out to me.
Did you ever have a conversation with the defendant where he mentioned Jack Fox?
Yes.
What was that conversation?
He told me Jack Fox was the car dealership in which he got the car from. And he believed there was an incident later on where he was at the stadium. And he told me someone came to get the car, to pick up the car or whatever. And he thought it was the police coming to look for the car. And, you know, that was the extent of that.
Did he have a conversation with you about what he intended to do with the car, and particularly regarding an agent of his?
Objection, Judge. I've been asked and answered. This doesn't quite be difficult conversation.
This is sustained.
Well, did you have a conversation with the defendant about his sports agent and some instructions he had given his agent?
Yes.
Regarding the car?
Yes.
What was that conversation?
He wanted to figure out how he could buy the car or have possession of the car so he could, you know, dispose of it then. He wanted the car to be his, so we didn't have to go back to the dealership at any point.
He told you that?
Yeah, he wanted to buy the car.
And the purpose of the car was to do what?
He wanted to make the car his so he could get rid of it, you know, do what he wanted to do with the car.
Now, what, if any, observations did you make, Mr. Bradley, over those next several weeks and months regarding the defendant's demeanor, particularly when you would go out to clubs?
He became extremely paranoid of everything and everybody.
In what way?
He just called every, he just assumed everyone was a detective or everything, every matter was police related. Just his sense of paranoia was heightened. He was just extremely paranoid.
Did you become aware if he had done anything with his phone after the murders?
Yes, he had. He wanted a no iPhone rule. He didn't want iPhones around him anymore.
Had he previously had an iPhone the night of the murders?
Yes, previously.
Do you know what happened to that phone?
That particular phone, no, I don't know exactly what happened to
it. Did the phone number stay the same? Or did the phone stay the same for Mr. Hernandez?
I don't recall, but I mean, we used... I don't recall if the number stayed the same or whatever.
Did you ever see that iPhone that he had previously on the night of the murder?
Yes.
Afterwards?
No.
What kind of phone did he get after that, if you recall?
A BlackBerry Palm, I believe. BlackBerry phone.
Now, you indicated something about a no iPhone rule. What was said about that, and what did you observe?
He didn't like iPhones around him because he said that he learned that they could record everything at all times, and he didn't want them around him from, he said he learned that from someone in his organization, some particular meeting or something at the stadium, that he was informed about iPhones being able to record and hear everything, so he didn't want any iPhones around him.
And was there a situation or a conversation that you had when you got an iPhone from somebody?
Yes.
What was that conversation with the defendant?
A woman friend of mine purchased me an iPhone, and he got upset that I had an iPhone, and then he told me that she was probably a cop.
Did you have any other conversations with him about other things that he thought were law enforcement or police officers?
Yes, he thought helicopters were following him everywhere. He just thought there was a constant police presence around him at all times.
Did you ever see him exhibit what you've described as thinking people are police or law enforcement, exhibit that in clubs at all when you were with him?
Yes, an incident that took place later in Florida.
Later in Florida?
Yes.
What about any incidents at Cure with the individual who let you in? Do you recall any incidents in that regard?
No, I don't recall any particular incident.
Do you recall whether or not Mr. Hernandez's relationship with the person who let you into Club Cure changed at all over those next months after the murders?
I don't recall the exacts of that situation.
Mr. Bradley, calling your attention now to any conversations that you had with the defendant over these months following the July 16, 2012 murders. Did he ever have a conversation with you about what, if any, way those murders were affecting him?
Yes, he indicated to me that he had nightmares.
About what?
About the particular incident, this double murder at hand.
And did you have any conversation with him about you also having some experiences?
Yes, I told him I had a couple myself.
During those ensuing months, Mr. Bradley, did you ever hear the defendant refer to himself in a way other than he previously referred to himself as far as nicknames?
Yes.
And just to back up a little bit, what nicknames did he have back prior to July 16, 2012?
The only one I knew of was Chico.
Chico? And what nickname did you hear him refer to himself after July 16, 2012?
Double A.
Double A, and is that just two A's, or is that spelled double, the word double, then A?
I mean, I never saw him spell it, but double A.
And did you have any idea what that referred to?
Yeah, it was a direct correlation to this double homicide. He gave himself the nickname.
Now, Mr. Bradley, your relationship, you've testified with the defendant, normalized it at some point, and you continued to hang out with him, is that right?
Correct.
Why didn't you ever go to the police?
Well, at the time, I believe I would have been in equally as much trouble, I mean, as he would have been.
Why is that?
Because I was driving the vehicle when he shot the individuals.
And did you ever assure Mr. Hernandez in any way that you would not tell anybody?
Yes, I did.
What did you say?
I just told him at different points, you know, that I would never tell. I would never tell him.
Mr. Bradley, I'm calling your attention now to February of 2013, so a number of months following the homicides in July of 2012. Was there a point where you were planning a trip with Mr. Hernandez somewhere?
Oh, yes, I was planning on, what was the trip Mr. Hernandez planned? I was planning on going with him, yes, to Miami.
What was the nature of the trip, if you recall?
I mean, the usual. You know, we went several other times, and in my mind, we were just going to go party like we usually do.
Now, at this point, sir, again, it's February 2013. Had the defendant moved at any time between when the murders happened and February of 2013 from his Plainville apartment?
Yes, he moved to North Attleboro, Massachusetts.
Do you remember what the house looked like? Was it big, small?
It was a big house. It was like a mini mansion.
And are you aware of whether or not he had a daughter in the interim between the homicides in July 2012 and February 13th?
Yes, he did.
Your Honor, may we approach briefly?
You may.
Mr. Bradley, did you have the opportunity prior to February 13th, 2013, to be at the home of Aaron Hernandez in North Attleboro, the house that you described as a mini mansion?
Yes.
How many occasions were you there in that time period, approximately?
Are you asking me prior to February 13th?
Prior to February 13th.
2013?
Yes.
I couldn't really put a number on it.
More than 10?
Yeah, definitely more than 10.
And in the times that you were at the home of Aaron Hernandez in North Attleboro, did you ever see a firearm in the house?
Yes.
And the revolver or semi-automatic?
Semi-automatic.
And what did the firearm look like?
It was silver. Silver, had a brown handle, and it was... that's it.
And where did you see it?
It was a lock box he used to have, this box that had a lock on it that he used to keep it in.
Where was this in the house?
In the basement.
In the basement? How was it that you were able to see that?
Because I saw him go inside the box before for something else and then get the firearm.
Did you ever have a conversation with him about that firearm?
Yes, I don't remember exactly what was said, but he wound up telling me it was for protection of his home.
I'm calling your attention, Mr. Bradley, to the trip to Florida.
All right, before you get there, let me pause here simply to instruct the jury. The testimony you've just heard relating to a semi-automatic handgun in North Attleboro. That evidence is admitted for a very limited purpose. That evidence, if believed by the jury, may be considered solely as it relates to the defendant's access to or possession of a firearm. It is not to be considered in any way as any evidence demonstrating or showing either bad character or showing a propensity to commit a crime with a handgun. Again, it's relevant only to the extent it demonstrates the defendant's access to a firearm or handgun. Mr. Hagan.
Mr. Bradley, calling your attention now to what I believe you testified to was a trip to Miami area in February of 2013. Do you recall what the event was that you were going to or the reason for the trip?
We were going down there. It was for a Super Bowl party.
Do you know who was hosting the Super Bowl party?
No, I don't know the exact name of the gentleman. It was a player from the Ravens. I can't remember his exact name, whose party it was.
A player from the Baltimore Ravens football team?
Correct.
Had they won the Super Bowl that year, if you recall?
Yes.
Who went on the trip to Florida as far as you and Mr. Hernandez? Was it just the two of you?
Yes.
And calling your attention now to honor about February 8th, 2013, did you fly with Mr. Hernandez to Florida?
Yes.
What part of Florida?
I believe we arrived at either West Palm Airport or Fort Lauderdale. I'm not sure which one of those airports.
What was the plan, Mr. Bradley, as far as how long were you planning to stay down there, and were you planning to go anywhere else afterwards?
I didn't really have a plan on how long we were going to stay down there. And I believe I was going to go down there and then go with him to Arizona after that.
What did he have in Arizona after that?
He had some type of endorsement situation.
Who paid for the tickets down to Florida?
I believe he paid for the ticket to Florida.
Do you know whether or not you purchased a return flight or he purchased a return flight?
To my knowledge, there was no return flight purchase.
When you arrived at the airport, which you believe was West Palm, did anybody greet you there and give you a ride?
Yes, some friends of Mr. Hernandez met us there.
What do you remember about the friends as far as what they looked like and what, if any, names or nicknames you recall?
I remember one guy's name was D, and I don't recall the other gentleman who he came with. I don't remember his name, but I know the other gentleman's name was D.
And when you got to the airport, the man D, did he appear to know Mr. Hernandez?
Yes.
Did Mr. Hernandez appear to know him?
Yes.
Show your photograph, sir. Do you recognize the two individuals in the photograph?
Yes.
And who do you recognize the two individuals to be?
Mr. Hernandez and the guy D.
The guy D?
Yeah.
There are for the photographs the next number to do.
No objection, Mr. Harry. Good, that's received. 284. 284.
And the individual on the left, that's D, sir?
Yes.
Do you know what his occupation was?
I believe he was a football player as well.
For which team?
For the Ravens.
Is that whose party it was, to your knowledge?
No, the party wasn't his, but it was another player.
So once you got picked up at the airport by D, was there someone else there as well, or was it just D?
It was D and another individual.
But you don't remember that person's nickname?
No.
Once they picked you up, where did you go?
We went to a hotel, straight to a hotel.
Do you remember what the name of the hotel was or what, if any, landmarks were nearby?
I think it was called Spring Hill Suite or something like that. I think that was the name of the hotel.
Do you recall whether or not the Super Bowl party was that night you arrived or a later date?
I believe it was the night we arrived. If not, it was the next night, but I believe it was the night we arrived.
Where was the Super Bowl party?
In a town called Belgrade.
Had you ever been to Belgrade prior to that?
No.
Do you know who of the group that you were in now, being Mr. Hernandez D, another man, and yourself, who was from Belgrade, if anybody?
I believe D might have been from the Belgrade area. I don't know if I believe the other individual was too, that he was with.
Now, up until this point, Mr. Bradley, had you had any altercations or arguments with Mr. Hernandez at all?
None.
Had you had any problems even in the months prior to traveling to Florida with Mr. Hernandez?
None of any significance.
Did you go to the Super Bowl party with him?
Yes.
Was it at a club or a restaurant? Where was it held?
It was originally in a housing complex at first. It was like a block party type of thing. And from there we went to some hall. I don't know what the name of it was.
And you went there with Mr. Hernandez?
Correct.
Did you meet some of his other friends at the party?
Yes.
Do you remember any of them by name?
I remember an individual named Papu. I remember another individual, actually. That might be it for like other than Mr. Hernandez and Dee that I met originally. And that other...
Somebody named Papu?
Yes.
Showing your photograph, sir, I'd ask you if you recognize the person depicted in that photograph?
Yes.
Who do you recognize that to be?
Papu.
Papu?
Yes.
And just for the record, is that P-A-P-P-O-O, if you know?
Sounds like, yeah.
Sir, so the photograph identified as Papu be marked as next member to exhibit.
No objections to Papu.
Without objection, Papu was received.
And what was his involvement in the party? Sir, I've placed exhibit 285 on the screen, the person you identified as Papu. What was his involvement in the party, if you know?
I don't believe there was any. I believe he was just a friend of Mr. Hernandez, just one of the guys around. I didn't know of any involvement.
Calling your attention now to after the Super Bowl party, did you all go back to the same hotel room?
Yeah, we stayed at that hotel, I believe, for definitely the first night or two.
Who else was staying in the hotel room besides you?
Some other friends of Mr. Hernandez and the other guys. Names, I don't really know.
What about the man D who, from the Baltimore Ravens? Was he there?
Yes.
What about Papu? Was he there?
Yes, he didn't stay there, though, but he was there.
He didn't stay, but he visited?
Yeah, he visited.
And the other person who picked you up at the airport with D, was he that at the hotel?
Yes.
How many other men or women?
Myself, Mr. Hernandez. I believe that's it as far as staying, like sleeping there.
And calling your attention now to as you were sleeping at that hotel room, how many nights do you think you stayed at that hotel?
One, definitely.
Did you switch hotel rooms at some point?
At some point, yes, we did.
Did you switch actual hotels as well? Like to go to a different hotel?
Yes.
Which hotel was that?
La Quinta.
La Quinta?
We went to a La Quinta Inn.
Do you remember where that was in relation to any landmarks in West Palm Beach?
I believe it was close to a Hooters restaurant and maybe a Red Lobster too.
At some point while you were staying overnight either at La Quinta or Spring Hill Suites, did you see a firearm in the room?
Yes.
Which hotel did you, if you recall?
It's in Spring Hill Suites Hotel.
That first night?
First day.
Was this after the Super Bowl party or before?
This was before. This is when we first got to the hotel.
And where did you see a firearm and who was around it or possessing it?
Another individual pulled it out and he passed it to Mr. Hernandez. He just looked at it and noticed.
What did the firearm look like?
It was,
Judge, I want Jack to ask if it was complete his answer.
I'm
sure. Witness didn't complete his answer before he was interrupted with another question.
Did you finish your last answer, sir?
Yes.
Very good. What a question, please.
You saw an individual holding a gun and handed it to Mr. Hernandez. What did the gun look like?
It was black with a silver top, I believe, to the best of my knowledge. It was... Looked like a Glock.
Was it a semi-automatic or a revolver?
A semi-automatic pistol.
And after it was handed to Mr. Hernandez, you indicated he handed it back? Or did you? I'm sorry, maybe I misheard.
No, I don't believe I indicated that. But he handed it to Mr. Hernandez, and Mr. Hernandez looked at it. I just remember it being left on the chair, put down on the chair.
In a chair in a hotel room?
Yeah, before we left.
Did you see that weapon again? During your time at the hotel?
That particular weapon, I don't believe so.
Did you see any other weapons at the hotel?
No, that's the only weapon I saw at the hotel.
Did you see that weapon in any other spot other than on the chair or in Mr. Hernandez's hand or the other man's hand?
I believe Mr. Hernandez was sitting on a bed. There was a bed. There was like a room in the bed off to the side. I think when Mr. Hernandez when he first passed it, Mr. Hernandez was sitting on the bed. So on the bed and then on the chair, pretty much.
Was there any conversation about the gun that you recall?
No, not particularly. I mean, they were just passing the gun around. I think he was just showing it.
Mr. Bradley, after the Super Bowl party and then going and staying overnight at a different hotel, being La Quinta, did you and Mr. Hernandez continue to go to nightclubs over the next few days?
Yes, we went to.
Which nightclubs did you go to that you recall?
We went to Cabaret Club. We went to Tootsie's Cabaret.
What is Tootsie's Cabaret for those who don't know?
It's a strip club.
How many nights did you go to Tootsie's, if you recall?
We went two of the nights down there.
The first night you went to Tootsie's, who went?
Myself, Mr. Hernandez, the guy D, and two other gentlemen, two other friends of.
Were either of those two friends the same man who picked you up at the airport?
The individual who picked us up from the airport, I believe he was only there the first time we went with D and Mr. Hernandez.
And calling your attention now to Honor About February 12th, 2013, did you go to a club that wasn't a strip club, a bar at some time?
Yes.
And while you were at the bar, were you with Mr. Hernandez?
Yes.
Did Mr. Hernandez call something to your attention?
Yes.
What did he call to your attention?
He pointed out two gentlemen with low haircuts, and he told me he thought that they were police officers. He told me they looked like cops.
Did he say why he thought they were police officers or why they looked like cops?
Not particularly. He just said, those dudes over there, I think that they're cops.
What did you say?
I told him, if they are, it's because of the stupid shit he did in Boston.
So if they are, it's because, say it again.
Objection, Judge. Counsel repeating again.
Well, let me ask you a
a new question, please.
What did you just said your own, you put your own self into the quote. What was the quote you heard Mr. Hernandez say?
Objection, Judge. Ask that answer.
No, you may repeat it.
Repeat the question, please.
Well, first, what did you say to Mr. Hernandez?
I didn't say anything first. He said to me that those guys looked like police officers.
Your response was what?
I didn't believe they were. I said, but if they are, then it's probably because of the stupid shit you did in Boston.
Stupid shit you did. Not. I just want you, before that you said that I did.
Yes, I said that you did, meaning me telling Mr. Hernandez what he did.
What was Mr. Hernandez's response to that?
He became like standoffish. He got upset, I could tell. He kind of walked away from me and walked over towards the bathroom area with a couple of his other friends. And he was just, you know, a little standoffish after that.
And did you notice that standoffishness happen after you made the comment about Boston?
Yeah, it was right after I made the comment.
What happened the rest of that night, sir?
Nothing particular. We finished partying at that place. We left. And I believe that was the first night we went to Tootsie's. That was night one.
Calling your attention now, sir, to February 13th, 2013. Was there a next time that you went to Tootsie's that next day?
Yes, we went the next night.
And that next night on February 13th, 2013, again after midnight, who went to Tootsie's the second time?
Myself, Mr. Hernandez, and two other gentlemen.
The two other gentlemen, had you seen them earlier in the week?
One of the gentlemen I did see. He was at the hotel the first day. But the other gentleman, I hadn't seen him at all until that night.
Was it just the four of you that went to Tootsie's?
Yes.
And one of the gentlemen you had never seen, hadn't seen before that night?
I didn't see him the whole time until that night.
What car did you take to Tootsie's?
We used a white Range Rover.
Do you know whose car that was?
I don't know who owned it, but the individual who was driving, who was the same individual that was around the first night at the hotel, arrived in that car.
Just backing you up a little bit to other cars that you saw during that few days in the Palm Beach area or Miami area, what other cars had you seen people driving or had you driven in during the time?
I saw a red Chrysler 300C. I believe a Porsche Panorama. Or
what color was the Porsche?
It was white. I believe that's it for cars.
Do you know where the white Porsche came from?
Yes, it was the gentleman D had the white Porsche.
D, the football player?
Correct.
Do you know whether or not it was his car or whether he rented it or what?
I believe it was a rental car.
Now, when you arrived at Tootsie's, Mr. Bradley, do you know about what time it was that you arrived?
It was, I believe, around 3 in the morning, or sometime close to 3.
How late does Tootsie's stay open, if you know?
5, I believe. 5 in the morning.
When you arrived at about 3 in the morning, just the four of you, did you go to a particular area of Tootsie's?
Repeat that, please.
Did you go to a particular part of Tootsie's? In other words, did you go to, if there's a main stage area, did you go to a private room? Where did you go?
We went upstairs to this area where there's private rooms, and we got one of those private rooms.
And did you have to pay for dancers at that point?
At that point, they weren't paid for yet, no.
But you had to get that room, you had to, did you have to purchase entertainment of some sort?
You have to put up some type of money. It's like a VIP room. You have to.
And do you know whether or not somebody in your group put up a credit card to pay for everything, at least initially?
Yes, I believe Mr. Hernandez did.
Calling your attention now to later on in the night, did something happen with your cell phone where you needed to charge it?
Yes.
What happened?
My cell phone was dying. I needed a charger. I asked a bottle service woman. She was like, she was giving us service in that room, like bringing our bottles or whatever. And I asked her if she had, I told her my phone was dying and I was trying to find a charger. And she said she believed she had one. And she went and retrieved one, but it wound up being, I believe, maybe an i4 charger. And I think I had an i5 at the time, so it didn't fit.
What did you do with your phone? When was the last time you saw the phone?
The last time I saw my phone was left on the counter, or that bar top, I believe. I thought I sat it down there.
Now, at some point towards the end of the night, sometime close to 5 o'clock in the morning, did all of you decide to leave?
Yes.
Prior to leaving, did the bill come?
Yes.
What was the total bill, if you recall?
I don't recall the exact amount. It was a very high bill, though.
Meaning?
I believe in the $10,000 area.
$10,000?
Yes.
Was there a conversation between you and Mr. Hernandez about the bill and who would pay?
Yes, he wanted me to split that bill with him.
What was your response to that?
I didn't want to. I mean, I didn't mind pitching in, but I didn't want to split it because there were two other individuals there who weren't my friends. So I didn't believe it was fair for me to split that with him.
Did you refuse to split it with him?
Yes.
What happened next?
He was upset about that. And it was, you know, it was almost time to go. And
did you get into the car to leave at some point?
Yes.
Was that the same white Range Rover you previously described?
Yes.
Where were you sitting?
I was sitting in the rear passenger side.
Where was Mr. Hernandez sitting?
Front passenger.
And where were the other two individuals sitting?
One was to my left. The individual who I hadn't seen up until that night was to my left. And the other individual was driving, whose Range Rover was.
As you left the club, shortly after leaving Tootsie's Cabaret, did you realize that you had forgotten something?
Yes.
What did you realize you had forgotten?
Forgotten my cell phone.
Did you say something or request that something be done?
Yes, I asked the driver to turn around so I could go get my phone.
Did Mr. Hernandez join that conversation?
Yes, he was telling, he objected. He told the driver to not turn around so I could get my phone.
And what did you say?
An argument ensued. I told him I needed my phone. It was important stuff in there. And he replied by saying, I'll buy you another one. And I told him I didn't need him to buy me another one or want him to. I wanted my phone. I had important stuff, my kids' pictures and other things in there.
And what was his response to that?
He just pretty much ignored me. He told the driver to just keep going, not to turn around to get my phone.
And did you get animated at some point?
Yes, I did.
What did you say?
I told him that I wanted my phone and that it was outrageous that they won't turn around and get my phone. I got mad at everybody.
At some point, did they ever turn around to get your phone?
No.
They just continued on?
Continued on.
Where were you headed at that point, if you know?
We were headed back to West Palm.
To the hotel?
Yes.
At some point during the car ride, Mr. Bradley, did you fall asleep?
Yes.
After falling asleep, was there something that woke you up?
Yes, the car stopped driving.
Now, with you personally, when a car stops driving, does that have some effect on you when you sleep?
Yeah, I wake up. When I fall asleep in cars, like once the car stops moving, I always wake up. I tend to wake up.
When you woke up from the sleep, based upon the car stopping, what did you see?
Mr. Hernandez with a gun in, pointing a gun in my face.
When you say your face, what part of your face?
Directly in my face, like in my, up towards my forehead area.
Was the car parked at that point or stopped in some way?
Yes, the car was stopped.
What happened next?
I made a gesture, to a defense gesture, to defend myself. And
for the record, you're taking your right hand and putting it up over your face?
Yes.
And as you put up the defense gesture, what happened?
He fired a shot. He shot the gun.
Where did the bullet strike you?
It went through my hand, blew my finger off. Well, part way off, and then it went into my head and blew my eye out.
Where did it enter your head?
Right above my left eye.
Right between your two eyes?
Yeah, up to the left.
Near your nose?
Yep.
And do you have a scar there where the bullet entered?
Correct.
Can you point to it, please?
It's right here.
For the record, you're pointing in between?
In between my eyes, upper left.
In between
eye.
Both eyebrows?
Yeah, in between my eyebrows.
You say it blew your eye out. Which eye did it blow?
Yeah, it traveled across and blew this eye out. My right eye is prosthetic, so it traveled across.
So the eye you have now in the right, that's a fake eye, is it?
Yes.
When this gunshot went off, what did you feel?
When it first went off, I just remember my ears were ringing, and then I know whoever this individual was to my left, I remember him trying to, like, push me out the car, and that's pretty much it.
Did you wake up to find yourself on the ground outside of the car?
Yeah, I mean, I was still awake at that point. I was never asleep, but yes, I was outside the car.
What did you see?
Mr. Hernandez's leg hanging. Well, when I rode over to a fence, when I first got pushed out the car, I rode over, and there was a fence, and I used the fence to kind of pull myself up, and Mr. Hernandez's leg was hanging out the driver's side door. The car was pulling off with his leg outside of the door.
How could you tell it was his leg?
Because he was the only light-skinned, lighter-complected guy other than myself in the car.
The other two men in the car, they were African-American?
Yes.
And what skin tone?
Dark-skinned males.
Now, how did you get out of the car? Was it just that the person to your left pushed you? Or
pushed me, and I believe Mr. Hernandez assisted him.
How was that done?
Because he got out of the front passenger side and helped that man. The guy was pushing me on my left. They were trying to pull me out the car and leave me there.
They both pulled you out of the car?
Yes, Mr. Hernandez helped that guy.
When you fell to the ground, were you bleeding?
Yes.
Could you see out of your right eye?
No, I couldn't.
Could you see even very well out of your left eye?
Yeah, I could see pretty well out of my left eye.
The car that pulled away, was that the same white SUV?
Correct.
What happened next, sir?
I walked to the end of an alley.
You walked? You were able to get up?
Yeah, I got to my feet from the fence, and I walked to the end of an alley, kind of to the end. It was like a parking lot off to the left. It was a warehouse there. And a guy came out, and actually before the guy came out, I wound up laying down. I stumbled my way to the end of the alley, and my head started hurting. I was getting a headache. And when I laid down, I noticed, like, my head didn't hurt anymore. Like, when I laid down on my arm, my head stopped hurting. So I kind of just laid there, and this gentleman came out, and he was, like, asking me if I was okay or whatever. And that was it. He wound up calling the ambulance or whatever.
How long did it take for the ambulance or the police to get there?
20-plus minutes. Over 20 minutes.
And were you in pain?
Yes.
Were you bleeding?
Yes.
Did you say anything to the men that came to find you, the men that you said came out to help you, or the man that came to help you?
Yes.
What did you recall saying to him?
I recall saying not too much. I think I remember
Do you remember if he asked you who had if you knew who shot you?
Yes.
What did you say?
I said a hiss, and then I cut myself off in the middle and said, I just said two black males.
At some point, did police officers arrive at the scene?
Yes.
And did they also ask you if you knew who shot you?
Yes, at that scene, I believe. I don't remember much after that scene. Do you mean?
At the scene, right there.
Yeah, someone did, whoever that guy was, that asked me.
And did you tell them who had shot you?
No.
Why not?
Because I didn't want to tell. That's not the route I wanted to take.
What do you mean by that's not the route you wanted to take?
I didn't want to tell on Mr. Hernandez. I didn't want to inform him that he shot me.
What route did you intend to take?
I wanted revenge. I didn't want to tell on him. I wanted to make it even.
Were you taken from the scene to the hospital?
Yes.
What happened at the hospital? How serious were your injuries?
To my knowledge, they were pretty serious. I know I had some head trauma, a missing eye, and I know I had like a surgery or something. And I just remember waking up. I think it was maybe almost a day later. I woke up some hours down the line, definitely.
How many surgeries did you have, if you know?
Total, I think I've had three total.
And your right eye, was that basically removed by the bullet, or did the surgeons have to remove it?
The bullet, from my understanding, the bullet removed such a large portion of it that they just, you know, whatever was left, they just took it out. I mean, it was never going to work again, so they just removed it.
Now, when you woke up at the hospital after what you just described, was defendant Aaron Hernandez there?
No.
Were any of his friends there?
No.
Did you ever receive a phone call at the hospital from Aaron Hernandez while you were there?
No, I called Mr. Hernandez while I was there.
Tell us about the phone call to Aaron Hernandez when you woke up that next morning.
I called him, and I said, "What's up?" And he said, "Who's this?" And
what did you say?
I was like, "You know who this is? Like, it's me. It's your boy." Like, sarcastic, with a sarcastic tone.
What was his tone?
He hung up.
He hung up?
Hung the phone up. And I called him right back again.
And did he answer?
Yeah, he was like, he was playing dumb. He was like, like he wasn't really saying too much. And he hung up again. And I called him back again. And I told him, I don't know why you keep hanging this phone up, because it's not like I told the police on you. You're not like, I ain't telling on you. Like, you know what time it is. When I get right, I'm coming back home. You know what time it is.
Did you know where he was at that point? If you know.
I didn't know for a fact, but he said, I'm still down here chilling, something along those lines.
Did he seem surprised to hear from you?
Oh, he was definitely surprised when he heard from me when I called.
Why do
him.
You say that?
Because just from knowing Mr. Hernandez and the tone he was using, he was like, like who's this? He was shocked. He definitely didn't think I was alive still.
Mr. Bradley, I'm going to show you a photograph and ask you if you recognize the person in that photograph.
Yeah, that's myself.
When do you know about when this photograph was taken?
Had to be right after I got shot in the hospital.
Is this a picture of you actually laying in the hospital bed, sir?
Yes, sir.
Does this fairly and accurately reflect the injuries that you sustained on February 13th, the year 2012, after being shot by Mr. Hernandez?
Yep. Yes, it does.
Run off for this photograph. Next number of the exhibit.
Without objection,
that is received.
Mr. Bradley, I'm not placing this in a gallery, I'm just placing it on your screen. Is that the photograph you identified?
Yes.
And that's you shortly after being shot, is that correct?
Correct.
Mr. Bradley, at some point, were you visited by Palm Beach County homicide detectives?
Yes.
Were you aware of why homicide detectives were called out to talk to you?
Yes.
Why was that, sir?
They wanted to investigate me being shot.
Did they indicate to you that they didn't think you were going to survive?
Yes, they did.
Did you give a recorded statement to a detective from your hospital bed?
Yes, I did.
Did you agree to cooperate?
No, I did not.
Why not?
Because that's not the route I wanted to go. I didn't want to cooperate with the police. I wanted Mr. Hernandez. It's his life.
Mr. Higgin, are you at a point where you're moving on to a new area?
Yes.
This would be appropriate within the duration of the lunch, or is it?